Good morning. Good morning, church. It's great to be together today. You got the memo, 10 o'clock this morning. That's great. No one showed up at 8:45, remarkably. So I think the memo did get around well. We'll watch and see if anyone comes in at 11. We'll probably be about done then. Just slide over and give them room to come in as well. This morning at the organ and piano, welcome with me, Nancy Graham. Nancy, thank you for leading us today. We appreciate you greatly. Wanda is out this morning with Will, and keep Will in your prayers. He's having some physical troubles these days, and pray for his quick healing and to get them back to their normal routines. But we're grateful to have Nancy with us this morning leading us. If you're here in person, welcome. If you're watching us online this morning, it is wonderful to have you. If you're listening by radio in a little while, thank you for joining us for worship today. What a great day to proclaim Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, to come into his presence today, to hear the message that he shares with our pastor to lead and to teach us. And then as we celebrate Holy Communion, what a wonderful time to be together today to worship. Invite you to stand and to greet those beside you this morning, passing the peace of Christ. Join me in our call to worship this morning. You know, God initiates worship. He loves to have worship from his people, and he calls us here. Welcome to you, the weak and the strong. Christ Jesus welcomes us here. Welcome to you, sinners and saints. God's grace embraces us all. Welcome to you, forgiven and forgiving. The Holy Spirit binds us in unity, mission, and love. Invite you to remain standing. Join me, hymn number 368. Hymn 368, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. Join me there.
In his righteousness.
standing as we join together in our affirmation of faith this morning. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
To open our hearts, to be able to come to the altar of prayer, to be able to come to God's throne of mercy and grace. And after a long week, it is truly a blessing to be in the presence of the Lord. We want to remember this morning those that are sick and shut in our community and our church family. Specifically, we want to continue to pray for the recovery for Mr. Eric Yance, Mrs. Ann Fuller, and Mrs. Tammy McMillan. We know that there are many prayer requests that are spoken and unspoken. And we invite them now, as we come to the throne of God's mercy, to pray together as a church family. Let us bow our heads. Creator God, we are so thankful for another day to serve you and to come before your throne with praise and mercy. We just stop to say hallelujah. Thank you, God, for shining your grace and mercy on us yet again in another day. As we come before you on this day, may your word feed and inspire us on this day that you have made truly for each of us to walk in your holiness. As we come to you and rest this morning, we recognize the contributions of workers in our country and the history of labor. This day, we allow the weight of our prayers to find your yoke so that we arise with a stronger faith, a stronger hope, and a stronger praise and a lighter burden. We invite your presence into this peace as we open our hearts, our souls, and our minds to receive your word from our pastor and a blessed union at the table of Holy Communion. As we come before you in our offering, we pray a blessing over the kingdom work that you have called us to do with this offering, and that each person that gives, whether in monetary deed or in prayer, that they be blessed also in the kingdom work that you have called us to do for the foundation of your church. We call upon your presence to reach our church family near and far, our community, our sick, our shut in, our imprisoned, those that are in need, and those that are calling out today on your name for your grace and your mercy. We come together boldly in our faith to pray together as we petition our prayer requests unto you, praying the Lord's Prayer by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In the time, I invite you to remain standing as we turn to the Holy Word of God. Scripture today is Jeremiah 29, just the one verse, 11. Hear the word of the Lord. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thank you. You may be seated. It is so good to see you on this Labor Day weekend as we turn to this pivotal word in the Scriptures. There's probably not a more pivotal word in all of the Bible or one that is more commonly used, similar to Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 that we preached on recently. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, and He will direct your path. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, He gave His only Son. Whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It kind of parallels, really, what Jeremiah is talking about here. And this is a pivotal time as well in the life of Jeremiah and in the nation of Israel itself. Imagine, if you would, that our country's invaded. It's overthrown. And we are displaced like refugees. And we're taken away from all the things that are familiar to us out of our homes. As a matter of fact, most of what we see has been burned to the ground. And everything we knew was lost. And now we have been taken forcibly to a strange land that we did not know. We are strangers in a strange land. You're forced from your home, forced out to a new existence, really, and then taken to a foreign land, totally unknown, separated from your family and friends. It's almost like going to college. No, right? It's much more involved. It's hard to imagine a worse experience where you lose everything. Not just losing what you possess, like in a major hurricane or weather event that we know about, but being totally displaced and living like a refugee, which you really are. I'm confident that if we live long enough, we will experience significant emotional events in our lives. One counselor called them sea moments. A significant emotional event. Moments of crisis. When a significant emotional event happens that rocks your life and causes you to see things differently than you've ever seen them before. Sometimes physically and literally so, but emotionally and spiritually as well. We can talk about pivotal moments, defining moments, where your life is shaken, turned upside down. You're put in a crucible, and you find out who you really are. You find out who God is, and you find out where He is going with your life, perhaps in a manner in which you hadn't seen it before. St. John of the Cross called it the dark night of the soul. I think those in Maui may be experiencing things like this, or those in the Ukraine, people whose homes and properties have been destroyed by natural disasters and have totally displaced them. This was a dark and bleak moment in the life of the nation of Israel and for Jeremiah the prophet itself. It was a time that was perhaps the darkest you can imagine. And God has this word for Jeremiah. I know the plans I have for you. We all might recall a statement that in yesteryears was a pretty popular statement. God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. It's a statement that has lost its influence and significance because it's been used so often, it can lose its meaning. I think as well, even as we say the creed Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, if not careful, we can become familiar with those words that they roll off our tongue and it loses its significance, its power and purpose in our lives that might be missing because of familiarity. Larger struggle, however, I think, is when we're in this fiery trial, when we're in the crucible, when we're in this sea moment, this significant emotional moment, we don't know the outcome totally or how things are going to turn out exactly, whether it's a health issue, a finance issue, a relationship issue, whatever it may be, we are looking for solutions and we're looking for them quickly. God, give us, if you have a plan, show it to us. God, we want to see your plan. Lord, we need it now. We were discussing the concept of revelation in our Ephesians Bible study on Wednesday night. And Paul was praying for the people in Ephesus. Literally, he was praying for them to have wisdom and revelation. I find it interesting that the last book of our Holy Bible is what? The book of Revelation. It speaks of future events and the consummation of time as we know it. The unfolding, if you will, of God's ultimate plan for the redemption of the world. If you look up the word revelation, it's a disclosure of something that we do not know, something formerly hidden or unknown. In its broad meaning, revelation is divine guidance or inspiration. It is the communication of truth and knowledge from God to His children on earth, suited, notice what it says here, suited to their language and understanding. In other words, in a way in which we can know this. It simply means to uncover something not yet known. And here we see in this context, God using Jeremiah as God used other prophets to reveal God's word in the midst of that bleak and dark time. In that sea moment, God was revealing his plan. We can say that God has an ultimate plan for his people and the entire creation. We mentioned that we see the culmination of that plan in Revelation with the second coming of Jesus and the consummation of all things. Jesus will be Lord over all creation. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. We know how the final chapter ends in Revelation. That is glorious good news for us. But I find it quite interesting, as I think about the unfolding of God's larger plan for the salvation of the world, the foretelling of this plan all the way back in the book of beginnings in Genesis. One of those scriptures, again, that is pivotal is Genesis 3:15. God speaking actually to Adam and Eve and the serpent Satan, and he said, "I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel." That is a word God spoke after the fall of humanity, after the curse was placed over the earth. God had a plan. God had a plan. And this was God's victory lap over the enemy. Even in the midst of the world-changing fall that happened, God had a plan. Satan's head would be crushed. As Luther wrote in his great hymn, "A Mighty Fortress, the Prince of Darkness grim, we tremble not at him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word will fail him. One little word will defeat him." Wow, does God have a plan? Absolutely, without question. From the beginning of time in Genesis all the way through to the book of Revelation, from one beginning, Alpha and Omega, God has a plan, an ultimate plan. It's college football season. I guess everybody here nearly is happy this morning. They should be. Maybe minus some Gators and Mountaineers this morning. But I find it interesting. Every coach and team has a plan. Have a game plan. Some might be better than others. Some might be more effective than others. They call it a game plan. It may not be carried out or executed as they would desire, but there is a plan. Friends, I want to tell you, God has a plan. He has a plan for the fulfillment of all time and the restoration of the creation. And I believe more personally, God has a plan for each of us within that larger plan. You might say, well, what is that? What does that entail? Note what it says here in this plan. He says, to prosper you, not to harm you. God's plan is always for our good. Say that with me. God's plan is always for good. Let's say that again. God's plan is always for good. And I want you to note that. It does not mean that everything good is going to happen. That is where we often misunderstand. We want God to reveal the plans like the blueprints of a house. And this is where many struggle to understand. More on this in a moment. But God's plan is always for our good. If you go back to Genesis again, and you look at the creation account in the early chapters of Genesis, there's real insight into the purpose and plan of God. As you read through those and the creation account itself, creation comes after the darkness and chaos are overcome and removed. Light and life are brought into the creation. And then God placed Adam and Eve right in the midst of that marvelous place that we call the Garden of Eden. We associate it with paradise. It was absolutely the finest place we could even imagine or dream of. God, that's where God placed Adam and Eve, right in the midst of the ultimate beauty and peace and harmony of that garden. This is God's plan. That's his original plan and design. It speaks to us of the character of God, to prosper, to do good to all creation, not to harm us. God removed the chaos and the darkness before he placed Adam and Eve. God knew the bad out before he put them in. It's incredible to think how special God made the creation. What a great and awesome God we serve. Even in the midst of the fallen creation, we see the beauty, even in the brokenness around us, the signs of God's goodness still with us. But the important point here is God brought order out of chaos, light into darkness, peace and harmony. Then came the fall and the rebellion of Adam and Eve and the curse and the brokenness in our world. The peace was broken. The plan was not totally lost, but it was diverted. Our sin and our chaos brought back darkness into the creation. God took it out, and we brought it back in. But guess what? God still has a plan. We're right in the middle of this world. We're right under the curse, where terrible things do happen and are happening. And when you're in the midst of the darkness, when you're in the middle of a sea moment in your life, it's hard to see clearly in those moments. It's hard to see anything clearly. When things are not going well, it's not unusual for us to question the presence of God or the purpose of God or the power of God. That was certainly the case with Jeremiah. He's known as the weeping prophet, the crying prophet. His peers ridiculed him. He was put in stocks. They really made a laughing stock out of him. They rejected his words and literally exiled him. At one point, they threw him into a well without water or food, thinking he would die. But God had a plan. God had a plan for Jeremiah. And on a greater scale, I believe during even catastrophic loss, even in the collapse of a nation, even when everything is gone, God has a plan. And it's a plan for our good. I was reminded again back in Genesis of the story of Joseph. You remember his story. The favored son who had the coat of many colors. His brothers despised him. They were going to kill him, but they ended up putting him in a pit, and they sold him as a slave to an Egyptian caravan. The scripture says God's favor was on Joseph. God had a plan. He went to work for Potiphar, acted righteously even in the midst of the seductive moves of Potiphar's wife. He ran from her. And then through her lives, he was thrown into prison. But the scripture says that God's favor was upon Joseph. God had a plan. I'm sure that Joseph had to be thinking while he was in that prison, Lord, what's happening? I keep trying to do the right things, and I end up in the worst conditions imaginable here in this prison cell. Bad things keep happening even though I try to do the right things. What's going on? God had a plan. The story goes on and we know it, most of us. He interpreted the dream of Pharaoh, became second in command in Egypt. He saved Egypt and his own people from starvation by storing up grain as he interpreted the dream of Pharaoh. During national calamity and near starvation, God had a plan. Joseph's own words make this crystal clear here. This is Genesis 50, 20. You meant this for evil, but God used it for good. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. To bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. Another translation, you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good. He brought me to this position so I could save the lives of many people. Let us all affirm today, in the midst of calamity, in the midst of chaos, in the midst of darkness, God has a plan. And it's for our good. Even through harm that may be generated. It's a story of redemption. It's a story of forgiveness. It's a story of reconciliation. That's God's plan. And that really prefigures the fulfillment of that coming into the New Testament for Jesus. The story of Joseph is really a prefiguration of Christ. Notice what he says next here. I know the plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. Other translations say, I have plans to give you a future filled with hope. Humanity is fascinated with knowing the future and our quest to find solutions and answers to what the future is going to hold. People turn to fortune tellers, witchcraft, horoscopes, palm reading, you name it. For hundreds, if not thousands of years, people have been searching for answers into the future about what's going to happen. They want to know. And so often we take matters into our own hands and even play God, trying to find those answers, or manipulating people and circumstances to try to create our own future. But this says, I know the plans I have for you. Someone has somewhat humorously said, if you want to hear God laugh, tell him your plans. But here's the problem. Even if we were able to foresee the future, could we change it? This is like the old movie, Back to the Future, remember that? Somehow, if you knew the future, you could make decisions today that would change the future somehow, in effect, change the course of history by doing something different. If we knew that plane was going to crash, we would not have boarded it. Or if we knew that car was going to crash, we would not be a passenger in that car. Or more positively and almost humorously, in the movie, the guy had a sports section and knew the scores and what they were going to be and was making bets and scores for a big payoff. But even knowing the future cannot change our mortality. God has designed how his plan will be revealed. He's called prophets like Jeremiah to speak his word, to help direct people according to God's plan. But in the greater light of the scripture, what we talked about last week, God has made us so that we don't always know the future. Very seldom do we know, unless God chooses to reveal it. We walk by faith, trusting God for what we do not see. We've been having some really dry weather. We were hoping for more rain. We may be having health conditions and we're worrisome and it's painful and we're hoping for relief. We're struggling as a parent with decisions we're making, hoping for wisdom to be guided correctly in parenting. We're not sure about our job situation and what's going to unfold with that, and we want to find something more fulfilling and more steady and more satisfying. We're hoping for that, but we really can't see it. And there are even more extreme circumstances like Jeremiah's case here. Problems on a national scale. It's not just a question of thriving, but of surviving. I remember a story from the Korean War of a journalist who was visiting a Marine base camp. It was one of the one of the coldest winters on record. It was nearly 42 below zero. The Marine she was talking to was eating beans from a can. And the journalist asked that Marine, if I could give you anything in the world right now, what would it be? And he said, give me tomorrow. Can you give me tomorrow? Dr. John Oswalt, who spoke earlier this year, commented on this dark time in Israel's history, and he said, no nation or group ever came back from exile. It was fully expected that they would not recover from this experience. In essence, they were placed in a hopeless situation. There was no way out. But God says different. I know the plans I have for you. Plans that are good. Plans for hope and a future. You remember the story back in Genesis again of that famous scene after the Israelites are delivered by the miraculous hand of God and they're camped by the Red Sea and the Egyptians decide they're not going to let them go. And they're camped, and the Red Sea's in front of them, and the mighty Egyptian army is behind them, and they're trapped, and there's no way out. And what do you do in that situation? Panic? They even wanted to kill Moses for leading them out there into this hopeless situation. But Moses was a prophet too. And what did he say? Stand still. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Stand still and see God work. God has a plan. It's for our good. And we know they went through the sea on dry ground. And the waters came back and covered the Egyptians. Not only are they saved, but the enemies are defeated, totally taken out of the picture. And Miriam leads the song of victory. I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and the rider thrown into the sea. God has a plan. I shared at Leon Allen's service earlier this year. And shared one of the last conversations that we had. I really prayed about sharing this, but I thought it was really appropriate. I've shared it previously, but it fits so well here. One of my last conversations with Leon, called me. He was in the midst of his treatments. Lord only knows what all he was processing in his mind at the time. He said, Pastor, I'm sitting on my couch, and I'm looking over my body, and I have a few scars. Maybe 6 or 7 scars. And I wonder about the injuries that caused those scars and the surgeries. And he said, then I thought about Jesus. He said, you know, Pastor, Jesus had so many scars. Had so many scars on his body, you couldn't count them. Couldn't count. And then he paused.
And he said, those scars were for me. Those scars were for me. Nobody could count his scars, but they were all for me. I've never had a phone call like that in my whole life. But those scars were God's plan. For our good. To give us a future. With hope. Loved him at Calvary. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Today, we're going to come to Holy Communion. And we're going to remember the ultimate plan of God for our redemption. And I hope as we take these elements today, we'll remember Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Thanks be to God for the glorious plan through His Son Jesus. May we pray. Lord, as we come to communion today, I hope we will remember your life, your scars. As we take the bread in our hand and receive the juice, it's your blood, your plan for our redemption, for our eternal future. And God, whatever sea moment we may be in our lives, whatever we're wrestling with right now, Lord, I pray that we would see you trusting in your work and the one who was slain before the foundation of the world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
As we come together this morning, our service of word and table, we come together at the table of Holy Communion. And our greeting reminds us that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And also, wait, I'm on the wrong version, but that's okay. We have something called grace and forgiveness. God is good. God is good. Bill's sermon still got me slain in the Lord a little bit. Woo. Amen. 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 I tried to keep going, but God said no. Woo. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. We give God thanks for the invitation to come to the table of Holy Communion because Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another by saying our confession and pardon together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen.
May we continue to great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. I want to invite those who are helping to serve to come in these moments. The ushers are going to direct you. We're going to form two lines in the middle aisle. We're going to serve you at the top of the aisle here, and after you receive the elements, you're welcome to come to the altar to pray as the Lord would lead you.
Thank you.
Our song of response this morning is not really a contemporary song, being about 25 years old itself, but I invite you to stand with me as we worship the Lord, giving Him thanks, surrendering our all to Him on this beautiful holiday weekend. You are my all in all.
We want to remind you of before we depart today. You'll find in your announcements many things, but we want to call attention to calling all singers and bell ringers to come forward and to share your gifts for God and your graces. And we need your voices and we need your talents. So please contact the church office, speak to Pastor Mike, and be a part of what God is calling you to do. Our puppet ministry is back up and ready to go for another season of Agape Hands. They will be holding their interest meeting on September the 10th at 4 o'clock p.m. on the West Campus, and you are invited to come again and share your gifts for this ministry. And get connected with our local missions. We have many missions that you will find listed on our website and in the bulletin. And if God is calling you to any of those places and spaces, know that you have a staff here that is willing and ready to pray with and for you as you discern God's best for you. As we prepare to part from this place, may we walk in the faith and the hope that God has given us this week. And may we not waver, but may we praise His name and bring others along with the great testimonies that we have about the plans that we know God has for our future. Go in the grace and the peace and the love of our Heavenly Father. And may the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit be with you. Until we meet again, my friends, shalom.